ready for the Mind Doctor Magnificent Show!
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Nappo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. We got some more music for you tonight. It's a story that plays very well into the whole reason why we started this program. You people who are avid listeners of the podcast and people who tune into the live stream know the story very well of why I started this podcast and the story behind the guy who told me I was living his dream when I went to buy an amplifier from him because he was retiring at the age of 69 and decided that the dream of playing in a band again that he always had since high school was never going to come true. And he was selling me his amp, and in his eyes, I was living his dream. And that was a perspective change for me. But the whole idea behind a lot of people get to the end of their lives and regret not living the life that they felt they were meant to live. And so my guest tonight has a story that plays right into that whole theme. And so I look forward to having this conversation and helping some of my listeners learn about some really good, cool new music. New music in the sense that it's new for the listener to hear it for the first time. It's not like a new style of music or necessarily fad music. It's actually traditional music, and you know me with labels, I don't like to put labels on music. So it spans. I would call it Americana. But we'll discuss it with him and see what he wants to label it as. And, you know, I'm not big on labels. But before I bring him in, got to talk about my sponsors, because that's what pays the bills around here. And that's what enables us to keep doing this program. So we'll start off with MyBookie.com. MyBookie.com is one of the most popular and trusted brands in the online gambling community. Its sportsbook offers an incredible variety of sports, from American staples such as football and basketball to international sports such as KBO, rugby, and cricket. I still haven't found that. What KBO is. It even offers wagers on entertainment and politics. You could have bet on the election. And simulated sports video games such as Madden 21 and NBA 2K21. If you're looking for a line on your favorite TV show, you can most certainly find it at MyBookie. MyBookie's casino options are as plentiful as the sports books. There are 27 table games such as blackjack and roulette, and almost 300 unique slot options, 77 of which are 3D. You can play live table games and video poker. To get started, it's really simple. You just go to mybookie.com and put in the promo code MINDDOG for a special match deposit offer. In other words, if you put down $100, they'll match it, so you have $200 which to bet with. That offer extends all the way up to $1,000. So if you put $1,000 down, you're going to get $2,000 worth of chips, I guess, to bet and play with. So it's a great deal. MyBookie.com. Promo code MINDDOG. My other sponsor, and you know about them very well, is Fundwise Capital. Fundwise Capital is a business lender matching platform that gets you the best lines of credit guaranteed. You can apply online in 60 seconds, and there's no effect to your credit to see how much you can get. Use the funding for anything you need to start or grow your business. That's right, I did say start. If you don't have a business, but you got a solid business plan, they can help you get funding. Their strategic lender matching platform searches through hundreds of lenders to find the very best possible option for your unique situation. They have hundreds of five-star reviews on Google, Trustpilot, and Facebook, and an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. They provide unsecured lines of credit at 0% interest for 9 to 15 months, unsecured term loans, loans based on income, short-term gap funding, or bridge loans. They work with real estate, startups, as I mentioned, franchises, real estate, any kind of business, any kind of project. To get started, it's really, really simple. You just go to apply.fundwise.com/minddogs. It's apply.fundwise.com/minddog. I wasn't sure which side we had the banner on there. And It's just that simple, folks. The links will be in the description as always, and I do appreciate you patronizing my sponsor. Now, back to the program at hand. Bill Abernathy is with us tonight, and if you're familiar with the story of Hank Porter and the Lonesome Cowboys, I invented a character called Chet Abernathy, which Bill played. My buddy Bill played for several years, and so last night we had Richard Lynch on, who was the embodiment of Hank Porter, and tonight we have Bill Abernathy, who is sort of kind of the same type of story as Chet Abernathy, who was Hank's sidekick and played by Bill, ironically enough. So here we go. Everyone loves a good story about a second chance, and that's exactly what Bill Abernathy's story is really all about. The Kansas City, Missouri resident began writing songs in his early teens, and he played throughout his high school years, and he stopped when life took over and Bill got married and raised a family. And when the kids moved out, he decided it was time to go back to the things he loved and rediscover music. And he has a band and he just released a collection of songs called Crossing Willow Creek, and it's available now with the first single, Cry Wolf, hitting radio waves around the globe. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Bill Abernathy. Bill, welcome.
Hey, thank you. Thank you very much, Matt. It's great to be here, and I'm excited to have a good discussion with you tonight.
I'm excited to have you here. I got to ask you about those guitars back on the wall back there. Is that a PRS over on the, I see on my right, it's probably to your left.
Yes, that is a PRS. It's one of the special ones, I suppose. So it's a combination of electric and acoustic. So it has electric pickups, and it also has the piezo acoustic pickups, and it has two outs on the guitar. So I can actually, when I record with that particular guitar, I record one line out to a electric amp and another into an acoustic amp, and it gives me the sound that I'm looking for.
Right.
So, one particular song.
That one caught my eye. I see all of the wonderful acoustics back there, and I'm probably guessing they're probably like Martins or Taylors or something.
Yeah, I have Martins, but I don't play them, so they don't get displayed on the wall. So I have behind me, I have two Guild 12 strings. One of them is a 1974 vintage, and the other one is about a, I don't know, 2009, something like that. And then I have my weird guitars. So you're a guitar guy, right?
Yeah.
We all know that most guitars have six strings or 12 strings. I have two guitars that have nine. So they're made by a builder in Japan named Kuzio Yari. They were distributed in the United States by Alvarez Guitars back in the day. They're no longer available. I happen to have two. I have a 1980 version and a 1988 version of those. And then I also have a Kuzio Yari six string. I'm peeking into the camera here to see a Kuzio Yari six string. And then I have the very first that you can't really see on camera. But I have the very first guitar that I ever owned, which is a silver tone that came directly from Sears.
I love those. I didn't have one, but a friend of mine had one, and he lent it to me, and I played it for two summers, I think. It came with the Dan Electro silver tone amp too.
Yeah.
I love that. You know, those were good guitars. They didn't get the kind of press that Fender and Gibson got, obviously, but they were good guitars back in the day, and I really, really enjoyed playing them. The nine strings, are the next normal size, or does it require like bigger hands to play?
Well, they're more of a 12 string neck. So each one of those I sent back and had the necks adjusted a bit, but they're more of a 12 string neck, so they're a bit fatter, but I kind of have big hands, and so I like big fat necks anyway, so it works out. Yeah, but they're more like playing a 12 string, so you know, the G string has an octave, and the top two strings are doubled, and then the bass strings are just singles, so they don't have the 12 string octave strings. So they give me kind of a different sound. And they really don't require nearly as much tuning as a 12 string.
Yeah, that's the one reason I shy away from 12 strings. I used to play one when I was a kid, 18, 19 years old. I was big on 12 strings. But, you know, and in those days, they didn't have electronic tuners. And so you'd be sitting there, you know, trying to hit just one string and not the other one at the same. And it got to be a pain in the neck. Today, it's a lot easier, though.
The first one of those actually has a story behind it. Actually, all of my guitars have stories, but that one I was playing, this is back in the day when I was young and pretty and had a full head of hair, and we were playing an outdoor festival in Chicago, and it was huge. It was probably 15,000 people there, and it was hot. And you know, the acoustic guitar dude, you know, he plays in the afternoon, you know, so I wasn't prime time in it, and the sun was out and it was beating, and I had four 12 strings. That's what I played in those days. I played exclusively 12 strings. And between every song, somebody was tuning some guitar for me, right? And we got back in. I had a guy that traveled with me who was my sound guy. And we got back into town, and he called me about 3 weeks later, and he said, I have found a guitar for you. Well, this is not something you're a guitar guy, right? That's almost like calling up and saying, congratulations, let me introduce you to your arranged marriage, right? people don't pick out guitars for you, right? But this guy, you know, he and I were really good friends, and he brought this thing over, and I sat down and played it and thought, well, this is a little bit weird. And then I played it a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more. And it really is, it's the one that I call the mutant, because it's weird. It's my go-to guitar. We've been all over the world together. So
wow. Before we get into your story, I just, you know, labels, as I mentioned in the intro, I hate putting labels on music. And one thing that really, I guess it's my own pet peeve, when we're getting ready to play a gig and somebody comes up to me and says, what kind of music do you play? And I never know really how to answer that, because my tastes and my influences are so widely varied that I'm not going to list them all. But the audience and the consumers want a label. They want to know what you play. So I have to ask you, how would you describe your music? What kind of music do you play?
Yeah, so there is a huge advantage, right, to being a singer-songwriter, because you could play in whatever genre you want to play in, right? And so you know, we're fortunate that over the years, you know, we've gotten play on country stations, we've gotten play on folk stations, we've gotten play on rock stations, blues stations. A friend of mine called me and said, oh my God, Bill, they just played one of your songs on a jazz station. So, you mentioned it, you know, in the, before the show started, you could probably call it Americana.
Yeah.
Because, you know, any time that you can have Bruce Springsteen and Bob Dylan listed as Americana, you pretty much span, you know, right. It's the span of every genre ever. And I think that they made up Americana just so they'd have another, Grammy category, but you know, there's a couple of things, you know, so when people ask me, you know, they say, well, what do you sound like, you know, who do you sound like, you know, I always just tell them, man, I just play old hippie music, you know.
Well, so. That sounds like me. I mean, I'm an old hippie, so
yeah. Yeah.
Without the hair, I guess. But so now your story, I think a lot of people can relate to this. You know, yeah, and I certainly can. When you're young, you have big dreams, and you're gonna get the record label and record deal and all that stuff. And the music business has changed so much since we were young, and record labels kind of disappeared. But life got in the way. You got married and had kids, and you were a responsible adult. And then at some point, I guess the kids went off to college or whatever, and moved out, and you found new inspiration to get back. Do I have that correctly?
Close. Yeah, you're really close. You know, so I think that you mentioned, you know, when you're young, you have dreams, right? And my first dream was to play football. And I was pretty good, you know, on a national level. And then I blew a knee, right? In high school, and that kind of ended that dream. And then it occurred to me, well, you know, I've always played the guitar. You know, I'm going to do this music thing. And it, you know, it did really well. You know, I got to tour and travel and did all that. You know, even when I was in high school, I was touring all over during the summer times. And even in school, I was playing, you know, 3 and 4 nights a week, you know, at different places around town. And I thought, this is great. This is what I'm going to do. You know, won some scholarships, blah, blah, blah. And then I had some problems with my voice, right? So if you remember back in those days, the hair band days, right? So I had some friends that had a really good band, and they were looking for a singer for a tour, not a full-time. Their guy was busy, whatever. And they were going on a tour, and they were looking for a singer. And so I went out and screamed, Kansas, Boston, Styx, you know, all the wow. arena rock, what I call the arena rock stuff. And that didn't work out very well for me. And I developed some nodes on my voice. And so the doctors told me, they said, they'll go away. You just have to not do anything for a while. Right. So I decided, you know, you have to pay the bills, right? You have to. So I went and got a job. And the intent of that job was that I would stay there 6 months while my voice healed up. And then I'd go back and, you know, get out of that screaming stuff, you know, and just do what I do. The 6 months came and went, and I still had problems, and then more problems, and then a surgery, and then another one. And at the end of the day, that dream kind of fell by the wayside. And so I thought, well, what the hell? I'm just going to be a normal dude. I've got a good job. I like what I do. I'll get married. I'll have kids. You know, have the big house on the hill, and the, you know, 2.3 kids and the 1.4 dogs, you know, whatever the averages are, and make a life out of that. And which is what I did. And so I didn't ever stop playing. I stopped playing out, right? I stopped performing, continued to write, continued to do all that stuff all those years. And then my kids, luckily enough, were quite the athletes. So both of them were Division I full ride ball players. And if you know anything about that life and summer ball and all that stuff, you have no time. Right. You're running around all over the countryside, watching them play, watching them do their things, watching them chase their dreams, and supporting all that. And so I did all that. And then they got their scholarships. They went off to college, played through their careers. My son played a little bit of pro ball. And then when they got done, they were done. They were out in the real world. They had their education. You know, they chased their dream as far as they could possibly chase it. I had supported that. As best as I could. And I decided, well, maybe it's my turn. So I picked up my guitar, started playing some old songs, and thought, you know, man, I just wonder. So I went in the studio, recorded a purely acoustic gig, a purely acoustic album. And one of the songs on that very first album won some awards. It got some airplay and got a little bit of love. And I thought, well, I wonder, right? So followed that up with another tune, another album called Find a Way, which is a far more produced event. And then we recorded the Crossing Willow Creek album, which is the one that you talked about earlier. And it has done exceptionally all over the world. And now we're coming out with new singles. So I often tell people that I did music backwards, right? You know, because, you know, you're supposed to do music when you're young and, you know, go out and do the rock star thing and, you know, all that stuff. And that didn't work out well for me. But when I got back into this some 7 years ago, maybe seven, eight years ago, I found that there is an audience. There is an audience for what I do. And I really appreciate that. And it's a lot of fun. And so I guess I am doing it backwards. And by the way, I'm just going to say this now, and it's going to be a world announcement on your show. I retire from my 9-to-5 in 6 days.
Wow. So, good for you. Congratulations. Yeah,
43 and a half years, man. 43 and a half years.
Oh my goodness. That's a long time. Yeah. and no job changes. This is just one job. This is the job that you took when you blew out your voice with the rock band. It's the same job. You stayed at one job all that time.
One company. Yeah. One company. So, I've been there.
Wow.
One company all those times. I counted this up because, you know, you're making your you have to do your announcement stuff, you know, when you're retired, and send out emails and all that stuff. And I was counting this up, and I've had 17 different positions in that company, and started at a very entry level and ended up working on the North American product supply leadership team. So worked my way through. So great place to work. It's been a great gig. I had my last conversation with my boss today, and tonight I'm talking to you. So let's turn the page, man.
Well, yeah, turn the page. That's great. So I'm curious. So when you decided, well, your first album that you cut was acoustic. So that was all yourself, right? And nobody else on that album. It's just you.
No. We had other musicians come in, but I had a rule about that because these were tunes that I had written purely acoustically. And so we did have other musicians play, but the rule was everybody had to play acoustic.
Gotcha. Yeah. Was it difficult to find, musicians, good musicians, or because I'm thinking, I know when a lot of people who I've known who not exactly the same story as you because, but they've been out for a while and then middle age comes and they start to get back into it and find out the musicians that they need to support them, are now kind of adults and retiring from the music business. Was it difficult to find good musicians to play with?
Not at all. So this is one huge advantage to play it, to live it in Kansas City, Missouri. we have tremendous musicians. You know, Kansas City's kind of known as a blues jazz place, but tremendous musicians. And, you know, I was very fortunate that through some connections that I had, I got some really, really cool people to play on that with me. And they enjoyed the challenge. Unplug, baby.
Oh, yeah.
Turn off. No fuzz pedals. None of that. Get a guitar that's made out of hollow wood and let's make some noise. It was fun.
I enjoy that, too. And you know what? I enjoy just when I play electric, I enjoy just plugging straight into a good amplifier and getting a natural tone with a good amp rather than going through a whole big wild pedal board and all that stuff. I know, you know, sometimes effects are necessary, but I really like purity of the instrument in a lot of ways. But listening to what I listen to, sounds extremely well produced. Are you producing it yourself? Did you hire a producer? How's that working for you?
Yes and yes are the answers. So I co-produce, right? I co-produce with another guy. So I'm not, I'm a singer-songwriter and I know what I do, right? And I'm comfortable in my skin. I can play the acoustic guitar. I could write some songs. I can sing a bit, right? As far as being able to hear all of the things and all the options and all of the alternates, alternative sounds that real producers could do, I don't necessarily do that. And so I co-produce with the Kansas City legend, actually. His name is Max Berry. And Max brings in that element. He says, you know, Bill, it would be really cool if we had B3 organ on this, or it'd be really cool if we brought a violin in, or it'd be cool. I got one that I'm working on right now, and I know that friends don't let friends play banjo, but I'm going to play banjo on this song. Just say it. So, you know, it's the sound, right? So, I co-produce with Max.
So, have you played banjo before?
So I don't really know how old you are, but when I was a kid, a little kid, you know, Saturday night when you had three channels, right? And you know, the aluminum foil on the antennas and all that stuff, right? Saturday night was family night, and Saturday night was hee-haw, right? My dad was a fan, right? And he told me that the only way that he would let me do all the things that I wanted to do musically was if I could play like Roy Clark. So, as you know, Roy Clark... I can't play like Roy Clark, just saying. I played like Roy Clark enough to fool my dad, right? But fantastic musician, and my dad convinced me and bought me, actually, a banjo because he wanted to hear me play the banjo. And so, yeah, I could play the banjo a bit. So,
Well, I have a different kind of story, but it starts with a banjo. I always wanted to play guitar. When I was 5 years old, I wanted to play guitar. And my parents were fans of hee-haw, too. And but they weren't too smart as far as musical stuff goes. And so my mom went out and bought me a four-string banjo, which is a tenor banjo, which is like ridiculous. It's a tootsy and ragtime type of stuff, not the Roy Clark banjo five string. And so I began taking lessons. I wanted to play guitar, and I got a banjo, and I was like, what am I going to do? So I went to town here where on Long Island, New York, where I live, and nobody knew how to play banjo. So I found a guitar teacher. It was an old jazz teacher, and he wanted to teach me how to play like Joe Pass chord melody type stuff, jazz, on a four-string banjo.
Why not?
So I was playing like Misty and stuff like that on a four-string. It was really took me years before I actually got a guitar and started to learn to play, though. Yeah.
There's an alternate to the banjo thing. So my dad bought the banjo because he wanted me to play it. And, of course, you know, if you're a musician, there's always women involved, right? And I was going out with a girl whose dad was a banjo guy, right? And he could play a bit. And so in order to impress him so that he would let me go out with his daughter, I had to learn how to play the banjo. So I had maybe different motivation.
How's yeah, that? Well, I was always, that was always my motivation, no matter what I did with
music. Of course,
music. Yeah, of course. You mentioned Kansas City and the culture there. I early on in the podcast, 200 episodes or so ago, I had a lady named Twyla Dell who wrote a book. It's actually about Fueling Change is the name of the book, and it's about how society has gone from one fuel to another, starting with, you know, wood or whatever, and the original fire source and coal, and now, you know. But she's from a Kansas City native, and she wrote that book essentially about climate change, but within the subtext of that book is how Kansas City, Missouri, is the cultural epicenter of the United States, and so much of our history, it revolves around what that part of the country, Kansas City, Missouri, is, and she ties it all into how it really is an important thing that for people to learn about. Now, I don't want to get into the whole history of that, but I understand that it's always had a rich artistic and musical culture there. Can you talk a little bit about that and growing up, what influence like the local area had on your music?
Yes, you mentioned Kansas City, so I'll do a little plug. I live in a building that was built in 1880 that is literally right on the Missouri River, and it's a building that at one point built parts and Conestoga wagons for the folks that were going out to California on the trails, right? The Santa Caligon, right? On all that. Cool old building. And I live right in the heart of the Kansas City, the world famous Kansas City City Market. And so great place, culturally so diverse and so cool. I really love living here. But from a musical standpoint, Kansas City is interesting. So, you know, people always say, Bill, when are you going to play live? And when are you going to play live in Kansas City? Well, not often, right? Not often in Kansas City. Main reason being that Kansas City is really a jazz town and some unbelievably talented jazz musicians. Hell, they're the guys I record with, right? They all come to play with me because I guess they need a day off and need to dumb down a little bit from all that jazz stuff that they're doing, right? But, you know, fantastic musicians. And, you know, Kansas City's also blues, you know, really great blues town and a lot of, I mean, some really, really fantastic blues players. But it's also a rock and roll town, and it's also a folk music town, and it's also. I mean, on any given time, actually, outside of COVID, you can find what you want to listen to, you know, all the way from I want to see some dude sitting in the corner of a coffee shop strumming a guitar, or I want to go, you know, see a cover band, you know, that's doing tributes to Bon Jovi. You know, I mean, that whole diverse thing. And of course, you know, we have the Blues District, you know, everybody knows that, you know, the 18th and Vine, you know, it's famous because of the song, right? Fantastic blues place. And just go down there and enjoy the ride. So it's really, really diverse. Musically, culturally, it's very cool. Kansas City's a pretty cool place. You know, we don't have a lot of the drama that we see on the, and I'm using quotes, news stations in some of the other towns, you know, that we're seeing today. Kansas City's it's a pretty chill place and really good people. So
really, and I wanted to ask you about that radio wise. I mean, the whole world from the radio perspective has been bought by conglomerates. So just about every radio station is run by one of six companies, and they tend to, you know, again, being an ageist here, we're older. We can remember when you'd had a variety of different kind of music stations, at least on the coast where I am and on the West Coast as well. It's just like one cookie cutter pop station after another. So I did mention that you were getting airplay. Are you getting local airplay? I know you're getting some worldwide, and outside of the United States, it's probably easier to get airplay if you're not doing that kid-oriented pop music that's cookie cutter. But for your music, are there stations there that are supportive of it in your area?
Yeah, there really are, and they're all over the country now. I have found that you live on the wrong side of the country, just saying, because most of my fan base is out to the west, you know, in Arizona and California, Colorado. Is it because that's where marijuana's legal? Anyway, just saying. there's some very good stations, you know, that play. Some are big stations, you know, big FM things. You know, some of them are the local, you know, like PBS types, you know, local stations. But you know, we get a lot of airplay. But in today's environment, really, the king of music is streaming, right? All the big streaming platforms, whether it be Pandora, Spotify, you know, pick one, right? That's the key. That's what people listen to anymore. So I listen to the radio, but generally speaking, when I listen to the radio, I'm listening to the talk radio. Because I enjoy that, especially if I'm driving someplace, right?
Yeah, I do too. But, you know, the streaming services are also, you know, I don't want to be put them all, lump them all together, but they are very young people centric, right? And so it's really hard to kind of make waves, especially if you are slightly older than your early 20s and not really TikTok friendly and all that kind of stuff. So how do you have somebody who manages social media for you and get that word out? Because that part of it has always been, I know a lot of people out there listening who are beyond the 35 age who are struggling to get heard on Spotify, on Apple iTunes and stuff. Do you have somebody that manages that for you, or you're kind of doing the marketing for yourself?
Yes and yes. So I work with MTS Management, Michael Stover.
Okay.
Fantastic guy, as far as publicity and you know, getting your name out there, lots of interviews, lots of reviews, and he gets me on tons of Spotify and Pandora playlists. And you know, we average, I don't know, I'm not a stats guy, I'm terrible about this, probably 50 to 75,000 streams a month.
Wow, that's very good for not being a kid.
all over the world. But it goes back to the whole thing, man. There is an audience for what you do, right? You just have to figure it out. You just have to find it, you know? And so if you look at the, and I'll go a little bit dork because this is a little bit of what I've done in my 9-to-5. If you looked at statistics and demographics and stuff for your music, you know, it's pretty easy to figure out who your audience is, right? So, you know, my audience is 45 and up. Done, right? Most are females because I'm such a good looking guy, I think. But You're supposed to laugh when I say that, right?
I smiled enough.
Okay, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm not that demonstrative with the.
I'm about 60% female, and you know, there are people out there that like old hippie music. You know, stuff that reminds them of, you know, the Eagles or Dan Fogelberg or Stephen Stills, Crosby, Stills and Nash. You know, that style of music. There are people out there that are looking for the new guys that sound a bit like that. You know, right. And so, you know, I have some songs that sound a bit like that. So, yeah.
Yeah.
But Michael does a hell of a job. He does a hell of a job.
I know Michael, and he's the guy who helped me find you. So, yeah, I definitely agree. He's a dedicated and very, very loyal, I guess, is the, probably not the best word, but a guy who is really in your corner and pushing a lot of new music my way into a lot of people. So I got to applaud him and give him his props for that. Yeah. But one thing I would probably disagree with you a little bit on, younger people today, I know a lot of young people, and they appreciate Bob Dylan. They appreciate folk music. And so I know a lot of people in their 20s and 30s who would probably – the problem is they don't have the incentive to kind of look for your stuff. If they heard it, they would probably it would probably resonate with them, and they would like it because they are fans of older music, classic rock and classic folk, and you name all that kind of stuff. So,
yes, I had the exact same belief. Okay, I had in the back of my mind, I have kids that are millennials, right? And I kind of thought, I wonder if, right? Am I really going to put myself in that box, right? That I really can't reach out to other people. So on the tour that I did, I was one of the fortunate people that got a tour in before COVID. I booked several shows just to find out, right? Just to find out if I could reach out and connect with that particular demographic. And you are correct. It can be done. Yeah. And there are folks out there that are looking for lyric-based music, that are looking for a good story, that are looking for something that you could take home and maybe learn from. You know, maybe it's a good thing, maybe it's a bad thing. Maybe I'll tell a story about, I've got a song called Whiskey Road that is written about a friend of mine that fell off that end of the world, right? Maybe that's a lesson. You know, that they can take back and say, you know, maybe I shouldn't do that, you know? And so, yeah, but it's there. And a couple of the shows that I had were very, very young. The audiences were, you know, 30s and below. And once they figured out that the old gray hair boomer was not such a bad guy, you know? They got it. It was fun.
You know, and it surprises me because I look at it through a comparative lens, meaning this. When I was 20, if somebody would have asked me to listen to the music my parents listened to, there's no way you could have got me to do it. And I would have been like, are you crazy? I'm not that old. And and listening to it made me square. Today I find more young people know classic rock and classic, that era of 60s, 70s and that stuff very well. Yeah. And they're well versed in it. And that's surprising to me. I want to talk about your single, Cry Wolf. When I was a very young boy, my favorite story of all was The Boy Who Cried Wolf. Yeah. And a young protege of mine, it's like a second son to me, today on social media, he wrote a poem called Cry Wolf. And I was like, wow, that's really, you know, synchronicity and stuff. What is the story behind Cry Wolf? Is it aligned with the Boy Who Cried Wolf?
Yes, very much so. The story of Cry Wolf, I'd been out playing around with my grandsons. So I have grandsons that are now, they're twin boys, and they're now 15, right? And I'd been playing baseball. I'd been out throwing the ball around with them one day, stepped in a hole, and tore my Achilles tendon. So I had to have this surgery, right? Now, I'm not that much of a dude that sits around, You know, I like to stay active. I like to stay up moving around. And here I am with this Achilles thing. I got nothing to do. I got to keep my toes above my nose. I mean, it was painful, not pleasant, right? And so what do you do, right? What do you do when you're sitting there? You can't do anything. You can't really work, you know, because your mind's all fogged up, right? So I flip on the television and I start watching the news stations, right? The opinion stations, the pundit stations that, you know, that we don't necessarily have news stations anymore, right?
Right, absolutely.
And I was watching this and I got fascinated because I don't lock in on just one, right? I flip stations all the time, about every 15 minutes, because if you do that, it is absolutely fascinating the different spins that you hear from the different stories, right? And, you know, whatever the tweet of the day is, you know, it's breaking news. It's a news flash. It's you know, all that, right? Well, then I was also sitting there looking at social media at the same time, right? Which, by the way, is a dangerous thing to do, just say it. And then I got fascinated by how quickly the latest news flash, the latest breaking news got repopulated out to social media, pick a platform, right? Without any kind of vetting, without any kind of fact checking, without it, it's just boom, right? And here's these folks and they're doing this and it's consistent, right? It's consistent. And I was sitting there thinking about that because, you know, I'm not that guy. You know, I'm the guy that I kind of like to do a little bit of homework, you know, before I say, you know, this or that, right? And I got to think, well, what is that like? Because really, at the end of the day, if you're posting 10 to 15 political posts a day, who's actually going to pay attention? Right. Nobody. You've worn it out, right? So a lot of people do this in the music world with their social media stuff. They're blasting out crap. You know, I shouldn't say that. They're blasting out information, right? You know, 3, 4, 10 times a day. You know, I've got a couple of people that I follow. I get 4 or 5 emails from them a day. Well, it's some element. I'm not going to open that, right? I'm sure the world hasn't changed in 15 minutes enough for you have to send me another email. Just say it, you know? So what is that like? It's like the boy who cried wolf, without question, right? I mean, how often can you throw it out there and actually have people respond? Or if you throw it out too much, do people just say, "Eh, I'm not paying any more attention"? And at some point, man, you're going to have something to say that is actual value add, right? And nobody's going to pay any attention because you've worn them out, you know? So it's the boy who cried wolf. And that was the impetus behind that song. And then of course, you know, it's a statement really, you know, about politics. It's a statement about media. It's a statement about some of our religious organizations, right? I turn on the TV and what do I see? Another politician in a broken governmental machine, you know, assuring all the masses they're building our American dream while spending all their time debating the latest tweet. I mean, that's real, man. That happens.
Right, you know? Right. Yeah.
And it's craziness, you know. But I'm also a bit of a science fiction guy, right?
Wow.
And there is a phrase in that song, because I think that some of the science fiction writers, particularly some of the classics, were really more prophets than they were science fiction writers at some level. If you haven't read Atlas Shrugged by Ayn Rand and you watch the news and see what's going on in the world today, do yourself a favor, read the book, man. You know, I mean, she called it a lot of it, you know, but I do actually use a quote from Orwell from 1984 in that song, right? It just says that George said it right in 1984, he who controls the present has full control of the past so we can recreate it.
Yep.
Complicit with our alternate facts.
Very profound. Very profound. Definitely.
God, he wrote it. I mean, I just sang it, right?
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, that's really what Cry Wolf's all about. It's a statement about, please, people, you know, I'm not the guy that is ever going to tell you what to think, right? But I will ask you to think, you know, just take a step back and think about it. Does this really make sense?
Right.
Yeah. Hell, what we're living through today. I mean, really?
Right. You know? Well, it's a very confusing time, and a lot of people are dealing with anxiety, and uncertainty will breed more anxiety. And so it's not a happy time for a lot of people, but I want to keep it a little bit happy here tonight. Because if one thing I know, if we want to start a fight, all you got to do is bring up politics and or religion, and you're sure to get an argument going that way.
Without question. Yeah.
What I like to talk about often, especially when it comes to music and any kind of art, really, is process. And I understand that you're a lyrics first guy, but what that really means to some people think, for some people that means I like to really concentrate on the lyrics more than the music. But for other people, it means I literally sit and write the words out before I even pick up an instrument. Can you tell me a little bit about your process of songwriting and how it works for you?
Well, really, at the end of the day, right, I'm a storyteller. That's really what I do. You know, I just tell stories, and they happen to turn out to be songs. So something will trigger. Something will, you know, influence me, or something will inspire me. And I'll kind of think about, well, how could that be, right? What does that mean, right? And I'll literally just start writing down lines. Line after line after line. No cadence, no form, no structure, no nothing. Just thoughts, right? Just thoughts. And I kind of think about it like a puzzle, right? So you got all these disparate parts of the puzzle, right? And you have to figure out if they fit together, right? And how they fit together, and what that picture looks like when they fit together. That's where the song comes in, right? So when you have a story to tell, you know, and you want to turn it into a song, or, you know, it turns itself into a song, which is probably more, I don't think anybody really knows where music comes from. I think it's magic, but you take all these different parts of these different thoughts, right? And you start putting them together like a puzzle. And as you do that, you start hearing, I do anyway, I start hearing things in my head. How would that sound? What melody line would really affect that lyric? What could I do from a musical standpoint to accentuate that lyric, to accentuate what I'm saying in that song? So yes, I do write lyrics first. And then once I have the gist of what that is and what that story is and what I want to say, right, then I start putting it together. And that's kind of when, you know, we talked about genres. That's when genres come into play, right? So if you looked at the Cry Wolf song, Cry Wolf song's kind of a rocker, right? It's more of a rock song than it is anything, because that genre is what fits the message, you know? If you look at some of the other stuff that's on Cross of Willow Creek, so if you looked at kind of the title song for that, it's called Willow Creek, and it's a story about when I was a little kid and when I learned how to play music and how that came to be and all that. And it's very acoustic and very pretty, and it's very singer-songwriter folky, you know? So I think that the story and the lyric of the song tell you what genre of music to write in, you know, whether it be blues or rock or, you know, whatever. I got one now that I got to play a banjo on, just saying. I don't even own a banjo. I got to go get one.
Right. Do you think about the overall meaning of the song as you're writing it, like what you want, the message you want the listener to take away from it, or is it line by line?
The message that the takeaway is the first thing that I think about.
Okay.
Right? So if you don't know what you're going to say, then
That's what I say to people who suffer with writer's block. I say generally, if you're experiencing something that's writer's block, it means you don't have something to say. You don't have something to say right now, because the minute you have something to say, those words and the ideas will come to you, because there's something you want to express. So I thank you for that, because that's an important point that people who. But do you believe in writer's block? Because I don't. I think that's generally what it is when you don't have when it's not coming to you. It's just because it's your time to sit and listen.
Well, sometimes the best thing to do is walk away, right?
Right.
I was working on a song, and you know, as the puzzle starts coming together, right? You have to start thinking music theory. You have to start thinking cadence. You have to start thinking all those things, right, to make it all work. And I was blocked. I was working on a song, and there was a piece this much of the song that I couldn't get. It just wouldn't happen, right? I mean, I could have come up with something that was okay, but it just wasn't cool, right? And man, I sat and sweat and sweat, and I don't even know how many pieces of paper I went through and how many chord progressions and how many of this and how many of that, right? No idea. Got up, just said, screw it, I'm done, I'm tired, I'm out, went to the shower, wrote the damn thing on the shower wall in the steam, came out, played it, and moved on. Song done. So sometimes it's best just to walk away, you know? Don't right. grind so much, you know?
Yeah, and to your point, I forget who said it now, but about where the music comes from. Somebody, one of my influences that I can't even recall who said it at the time, but said that the music is out there, and we're like a radio antenna. It basically, you're just transcribing it from wherever it is in the universe, and that always stuck with me. So, and when you said that, it kind of reminded me of that. You're obviously. I think in your part of the country, COVID is spiking again.
Yeah.
So you're not performing right now.
Live streaming, which is actually spectacular for me. So I do quite a few live stream concerts, you know, for different people. I've been fortunate to do them kind of all over the world, you know. So I've done some live streams for some people in Australia and different ones, different folks in Europe and, you know, all over the United States. So, it's pretty sweet. I'll be honest with you. It's pretty sweet because, you know, my house is my live studio. Right. And so, you know, effectively, you know, I do a live stream show, play for a couple of hours. I don't have to worry about, you know, people having to go to the bathroom. I don't have to worry about somebody spilled their beer and caused a big thing. I don't have to worry about somebody on the front row talking about grandma's new car. You know, I just play. It's great, you know.
Yeah, because for somebody like you, in particular, the words are very important to the experience, yeah. And so that, and I appreciate that completely because I've as somebody who's written that, not all my music is like that, but some of my songs are you're meant to listen to them, and if you're playing in a busy restaurant or something like that, and people are chatting, there's no way you can really experience it and get the full appreciation for the song when there's all that interaction going on. Yeah. So sometimes the live stream is a better way to kind of share that the real meaning of the song. So I can definitely appreciate where you're coming from there. But with some of the, and I'm guessing you're doing it right, because some of the live stream concerts I've seen, first of all, this technology was not made for that. It's made for this talking head stuff. Right. And so the sound will crush. If you don't do it right and don't use the right kind of interface to get to plug directly in, and even just doing an acoustic thing, if I were to pick up an acoustic guitar and start playing it through StreamYard, it would kill the tone of it. So I think, you know, a lot of them, the ones I've seen that have done it right, have had like the sound really together and done it professionally, and like and understood that this technology was not made for that. It can be adapted to that. You got to turn all the compression off and make sure that you get going through the right way and all that stuff. But
I was laughing. Michael had sent me a note that you had said something about this evening, right? To make sure and go check, you know, all the technology, make sure that everything's working. And I like toys. I'm about half techie. Okay. I'm not really what I'd call a techie, but I'm about half techie.
Right.
And, you know, I enjoy using technology, and I think it's fun. And to overcome, particularly if you're looking at Facebook's algorithms and their compression is pretty brutal, right, from a music standpoint. So you have to figure it out. You know, you just have to figure out how to make it better. You know, if you're, you know, live streaming direct to YouTube, you really don't have that problem.
Right.
And then there's other services out there that are really more set up for music. But really, at the end of the day, most live streams are on Facebook. Mine are. And so you just figure it out. You know, but at the end of the day, I'm simple. I'm a simple dude because it's me and a bunch of guitars.
Right.
You know, I've got friends that are doing this whole live stream thing. And God bless them, because they've got a six-piece band and everybody's in their own house in different parts of the city, and sitting in the middle of it is some technical freaking wizard that's running all kinds of stuff. And it all works, you know, they all sync up together, and, you know, and it's like being there. Right.
Right.
God bless them. I don't think I would have the patience for that. And number two, from a live stream perspective, I find it to be as impersonal as it is, right? Because you don't have an audience. I find it to be personal. Because as I'm talking, I spend a little bit more time telling stories, right, and talking the backstories of the songs and how the songs came to be and all that. And then you start getting the folks that are interacting, you know, with you. And I like it. Just
well,
saying.
For a guy like
I'm one of the few guys that really do. Yeah.
Yeah. For a guy like you, it is pretty good, I have to say. One of the things that I used to really enjoy when I had television, I don't have television in my house anymore, but BH1 had a series called Storytellers on, and mm-hmm. it was like Jackson Brown and Bruce Springsteen, and it was actually exactly what you just described. You got to hear the backstory of the song. You got to hear songs that you knew well and were fans of. You got the writer to explain why they wrote that song, how they wrote that song, and what they were going through at the time. And it enriches your experience of the song from that moment forward. So for a guy like you, it's definitely ideal.
Yeah, you know, it's a fascinating thing. So I started doing this when I was on tour, because, you know, I mean, just to go out and play, you know, 2-3 hours every night, you know, it's fun and I love it, but it gets kind of boring, you know. Right. And so I thought, well, why not? You know, so let's find out if people know what these songs are about. Because I do play cover songs, right? I'll play a few cover songs, but they're the ones that have really touched me at some point in my life, right? And so they have a special meaning to me. And so I want to know if people actually know what this song is about, right? So I play games, right? And if people get it right, I give them a T-shirt or, you know, album or something, right? And I do the same thing online. And so I'll tell everybody, okay, this is the game. I want you to tell me the name of the song, right? The name of the person who wrote the song, which may be different than the name of the person that sang it,
right?
Right. And then I want you to tell me what this song is about, right? And man, you want to talk about getting some interesting answers, you know? Because I think what happens is, to quote Billy Joel had a song on his Turnstiles album that was called The Entertainer, right? And it talks about a song that he had written, right? And you know, the industry, right? The industry. It was a beautiful song, but it ran too long. If you want to have a hit, you got to make it quick. So they cut it down to 3:05, right? Well, that's programmed us, right? That's our attention span, right? People, lyrics matter. You know, I use that on my social media. Hashtags lyrics matter. Have for years, right? What's the song about? You know, what's it about? I mean, if you sit down and listen to a James Taylor song, for example, right? What the hell is it about?
Right.
Why did he decide to sit down and write that song? But the best one ever, and it's so funny to me, to do this. You mentioned Jackson Brown earlier. I love Jackson Brown.
Me
right?
too.
And I was actually asked back in the day, right?
You can bring up Rosie, aren't you?
To play a song at a wedding, okay? And this guy, he didn't know anything, right? But his fiance's name was Rose, right? And so he said, I want you to play this Jackson Brown song at my wedding. And I'm going, dude, really? Yeah, no, it'll be great, right? So when I was on tour, and I do it at the live stream shows too, right? It's fun to play the game, because then people pay attention to the lyric, because, you know, there's a question and answer period, right? And it's fun to watch their faces go, it's freaking great. I mean, I love it. You know, I love it. And but that's fun to me. But, you know, I think that we've kind of been programmed to tap our toes, right, and nod our head and not really pay attention. But, you know, there's a reason. You know, there's a reason Dave Grohl wrote that song.
Right.
You know, yeah. It's not because he had a cool guitar lick, right? It's because he had something to say, you know. John Mayer, you could go on and on and on and on and on, right? There's reasons they sit down and write that song. And, you know, if they just wanted to had a cool guitar lick, they'd just play the damn guitar lick, you know? Yeah. So what does the song mean? And to me, that's important, right? And so the live streaming thing gives me that opportunity to kind of talk through that. And it's fun for me.
Great stuff. We are just about at the hour now. Do you have any of these live stream concerts coming up planned or anything that you could let the audience know about or not?
Yeah, I do. I have one that is planned for the 20th, which is a Friday night, November the 20th. I will be officially retired by then. So I'm all good with that.
Congratulations again. Yep.
No, I'm pretty geeked about the whole gig, right? You know, so it's hard to wear two hats, right?
Yeah.
I'll have one on the 20th, and it'll be out on my Facebook stuff. It's for a group of folks in Kansas City that are full-time, musicians, and they, you know, they're relying on this to make revenue. I don't ask for, you know, donations or tips or whatever. But I do ask people to donate, you know, to help out somebody, whether it be another musician. I did a whole series of videos to help local businesses during shutdown. So, you know, people would send in a song request, you know, from somebody, pick somebody. And I would actually learn it and then make a recording and a video of it and post it out on my Facebook. And in response for that, instead of them sending me money, I would say, please go donate or buy a gift card or order out from a local, you know, and try to help the locals survive this whole gig. And it's coming again, man, particularly here in the Midwest. It's going to come and it's going to hit hard. And so we'll probably kick that back up a notch and do that over the winter again. I think that's a cool thing. But yeah, Friday night, the 20th, start at 8 o'clock. I'll be live streaming, baby.
Excellent stuff. Well, you made a fan of me tonight, and I'm sure you made some fans of my audience too, and the people who will be listening in the cars during the week here, because we do get quite a bit of, you know, a lot of people just listen to these shows on their commute. So I'm sure you're going to be making a lot of new fans this week. I look forward to it. Pat, your website up there, it's called, it's just BillAbernathy.com. The link will be in the description. I will also put the link to his Facebook page. So if anybody wants to partake of that that show on the 20th, we will definitely be looking in then. Bill, I thank you for your time. It's been great to get to know you. And you made a fan of me. But I've listened to your music before this conversation. But after the conversation, I'm even more of a fan now. I wish you great success and continue forward, man. Don't let it stop you. Enjoy the rest of your life here.
Well, I appreciate it again. You know, like I said, I appreciate what you do, you know, to help us out, you know, and get our names out there a little bit and expand the base, if you would, you know, expand the fan base. You know, it's fun. You know, it's just fun to have, you know, I don't know about you, but I've kind of been in quarantine lockdown. So I haven't been face to face with somebody having adult conversations for a while. So this is fun for me. So I really do appreciate it.
I played a restaurant last week and I got one this week. We used to do like 5 gigs a week. Now we're doing 1 a week, but it's so odd here, man. It's like, you can't play indoors. You can't play outdoors anymore. But if they can play in a tent. So if the indoors is outdoor, you can play indoors in an outdoor place, if that makes sense. So we're playing outdoor gigs, but in a tent, so you're closed in anyway. So why not just be inside the building? It does.
Yeah, when I got the invitation to come to your show, nobody told me there'd be math involved, man. That's way too complex. that's way too complex for me. You know,
yeah, I get it.
I'll play a few songs and throw it out on social media, and if folks have a good time with it, I'm good. So
great. Yeah. Well, thanks. Thanks for coming in. Continued success and stay in touch, man. Anytime you want to come back, maybe next time come back and play a few songs acoustically. We can probably get away with that on YouTube and stuff without them pulling it down on us.
Yeah, as long as I play all originals, we'll be good. So,
yeah. Okay. Cool.
Yeah, cool. Thanks, man. Coming.
Have a great night. Bye. Bill Abernathy, folks. Good stuff. I love his attitude. I love hearing about his process. I love the fact that he's a storyteller first, and his music comes from a lyrics guy who, you really have to listen to the lyrics to get the full experience of it. That's my favorite music to begin with. So I appreciate that stuff, and I hope you'll check him out. Once again, it's BillAbernathy.com. The links will be in the description. Please check him out and support his music, and maybe we'll all get together on the 20th and watch his show together, have a little watch party. So until tomorrow afternoon at 1 p.m. Eastern, when the daytime edition, Andrew Shatkin is going to be back. Andrew is a Christian conservative author. He's probably going to want to talk politics with the election just happening, but he's also got a lot of books on Christianity, and so we're mixing. If you want to start a fight, bring up politics and and religion. We got it both happening tomorrow night, tomorrow afternoon. So look for sparks to fly, I guess, within the audience, not me, actually. I get along with everybody, you know that. Anyway, that's at 1 p.m. I hope you enjoyed this program. Hope you come back, tell your friends about it, subscribe, go to my YouTube channel and subscribe there. Go to minddogtv.com, get on my mailing list so you know when we're going to have great guests like this on. And questions and comments on tonight's show, info@minddogtv.com. So till tomorrow at 1 p.m., I'm at Nappo for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for coming. Have a great night, and bye for now.